Thank you, Minister. Next is the question and answer session. I would like to invite Ambassador Pillai to join the Minister on stage to moderate this session.
Thank you, Minister, for a very comprehensive speech. I was very happy to hear that our one little candle, the encyclopedia, did some good work in Sri Lanka. It makes my heart very, very glad indeed. We don't have too much of time because the Minister has another appointment, so we'll restrict the number of questions. But I want to use my prerogative as the Chairman to ask the first question. And this is regarding the early part of your speech. What fascinates me of what has happened in Sri Lanka are three things. One, I wonder why President Sirisena, who was occupying a good position, who was occupying a very comfortable position in the cabinet of Mahindra Rajapaksa, to have left that and decided to lead the Rainbow Coalition, and knowing full well that if he had lost, the consequences would have been very severe. That's the first one. The second one, Rajapaksa, who is seen as a very authoritative person, accepted the verdict of the people, the election results, and moved aside for Mr. Sirisena to become the president. The third thing that fascinates me is the Sri Lankan army, though it had been given a chance to sort of establish a military rule or military backroom, it decided not to do that. So these three things make Sri Lanka a really fascinating study. Minister, you may want to comment on this.
Thank you, Ambassador. I would say, in response to your first question, that Minister Sirisena, he was the Minister of Health in the Rajapaksa regime for the last 10 years, and was also the General Secretary of the Sri Lanka Freedom Party, which President Rajapaksa led at that time, has told us that his conscience was hurting for some time, especially since the war was won in 2009, when President Rajapaksa seems to be using the popularity he gained amongst the people for defeating terrorism decisively, in order to establish a political dynasty of his own in the country. And instead of using the end of the war, that was a great window of opportunity which it brought to our country to further strengthen democracy and also win over the Tamil people, who were the victims of that war, his side. He used, as I said in my speech also, audio triumphalism, basically asserting his authority and that of his family in the country. The first bill which he brought to Parliament after the war was to ensure that the two-term bar on the presidency was lifted, giving him the opportunity to contest as many times as he likes. And along with that, he also abolished all the independence commissions, the independent police commission, the independent elections commission, independent judicial commission, and the government services commission were all dismantled under what was called the 19th Amendment to the Constitution. And they all became more or less certain appendages of the executive arm. So that many saw as the first step towards an autocratic form of obviously bothered the ministers to retain that. And when the time came for the presidential elections we held last year, because of the support he found from various sections of society, I believe that led to him accepting the challenge, as you said, despite the grave danger which were inherent in accepting such a challenge, because if he did not win, you know what happened to the earlier presidential candidate of 2010, who was imprisoned for several years. President Sirisena may have had to pay with his life, but despite all that, he took a principal position for the sake of the country. And the people of the country did appreciate him by the mandate he got. The second question, Ambassador, is not quite accurate, because the night of the elections, when the election results were being announced, there was an attempt by the president where he summoned the army commander and the elections commissioner, as well as the attorney general, to his residence and talked about the possibility of declaring a state of emergency and continuing. And in fact, I myself have made a complaint regarding this matter immediately after the election. And there is an investigation going on about what really happened that night. But what we have been told is what saved the day was the armed forces, the army commander, and the IGP both had categorically refused to take part in such a conspiracy. And therefore, he was obliged to accept the result by morning.
Thank you, Minister, for a very frank answer. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we probably have time for about two questions, or three. Make it short. Please state your name and give your questions, and Minister will be happy to answer them. Don't take too long. Yeah, Surya.
Surya always has the first question.
Minister, you have said that going forward, Sri Lanka will be entering into a new trade and economic and technology pact with India, and also a new FTA with China. And everyone outside of Sri Lanka tends to believe that both China and India compete for the affections of Sri Lanka. So could you compare and contrast the two trade pacts that you have in mind, please? Thank you.
Actually,
yes.
I thought about going to details of the trade pacts which are at an early stage of discussion, but we certainly, because this is only already have a free trade agreement with India and Pakistan both, but we are thinking of going one step further with this new agreement, which is something similar to CEPA, which was earlier discussed with the national governors. And of course, the free trade agreement between Sri Lanka and China again is at a very early stage. But I wouldn't agree with your observation that Sri Lanka, that China and India are competing for our affections, because we are working with both those countries as we have done so over the years as great and old friends of us, except India. India is not only a friend, but India is also a neighbor and has been with us in good times and bad. So, but that does not mean that India expects us to distance ourselves from it. But we have, of course, walked away from the earlier policy of being closer to one party at the expense of others.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Monka Shrestha. I'm one of the Ethnic Faculty at NBS. My question to Honorable Minister is, just like Sri Lanka, your country is already on the track for economic development, in a part of also ethnic, that the conflict is over and a new constitution is there, but before we could start any going on between Nepal and India in terms of the Niagara Falls supply. Now, Sri Lanka as a SAARC member, do you think there's some room, some role or scope that you can play in trying to sort out the issues in the two countries? Thank you.
I just said that if invited to do so, Sri Lanka would certainly like to help. Yes, in fact, one of the key promises of the manifesto of President Sirisena in January 2020 of this year was that we will abolish the executive presidential system, and within the first 100 days of the government, we brought what was called the 19th Amendment to the Constitution, where we proposed to amend to abolish almost all the executive powers of the presidency. But the Supreme Court held that to abolish some of the powers, that we may need to go for a referendum as well as a two-thirds majority. And it was in that context that we pruned down certain powers of the presidency in the 19th Amendment, which can be done without going for a referendum. But the balance proposals will be included in the new constitution when that's put to parliament. And we hope that we will be able to revert back to a parliamentary democracy, to be in a parliamentary democracy, once the new constitution takes place. But already, I must say, already some of the unsavory aspects of the executive presidency, like presidential immunity, etc., have been removed.
Thank you.
Next question. Munish, do you have a question? I thought I saw you put up your hand. Next. Yes, President.
Just a quick question about the main Western powers, the European Union and the United States. You've done a lot since you assumed office to rebalance foreign policy by repairing relations with both. How do you see them progressing beyond GPS Plus with the European Union and also with the United States?
In fact, since coming into the office in January, President Sirisena's government has again rebalanced our foreign policy. And the first steps, in fact, I took as foreign minister, in fact, the first foreign trip to overseas after going to India was to the European Union, because of the importance we place on our relations with the EU, and we wanted to restore some of the goodwill which may have been lost over the years. And then, of course, the next stop was Washington. And I must say that we have managed to, in a very short period of time, we have managed to restore our relations with both these important
power blocks, and that is why Sri Lanka also decided to join the open partnership dialogue at the invitation of the United States in Mexico a few weeks ago. And we hope that we'll be able to strengthen our bilateral relations in the coming years. We've already had the Secretary of State, John Kerry, come into Sri Lanka, the first ever, for the first time since nearly 20 odd years, the Secretary of State has come to Sri Lanka. And in fact, next weekend we are having the Ambassador to the United Nations, Samantha Power, who is also a cabinet rank member of the Obama administration, coming to Sri Lanka. So we see a lot of potential ahead for strengthening the close relations we have with the US and the EU in the coming months and years.
Thank you, Minister. I think that's about all the time you have. So, yes.
Hi, I'm Leon from Damson Capital. Minister, thank you again for your speech and really filling us with the optimism that you're really making the true transformation in the country. So understanding really the transformation that has been happening in the last couple months going forward, as you mentioned, the Bill of Rights. A few of the tenets to strong development is inclusive growth. And I wonder if you could give us a glimpse of anything that we should be looking out for in understanding what will come up in the Bill of Rights in terms of the inclusive economic growth and the social impact which you'd be building into the policy. Would you be able to give us a quick glimpse of that?
Actually, these are sort of, I just flagged some of the important areas which are to be included within the new constitution. But of course, the details will have to be decided by the Constituent Assembly, which will come into place from sometime in January next year, in 2016, where hopefully for 1 year the Parliament will sit as a Constituent Assembly and go clause by clause and discuss in details some of the areas you have mentioned. But of course, we feel that the most important, the most important factor in the new constitution should be the sharing of powers with other communities, which has been lacking in the first two constitutions. In fact, Sri Lanka, this will be the third Republican constitution Sri Lanka will be having since gaining independence and since becoming a republic in 1972. But both the Republican constitution of 1972 as well as the Republican constitution of 1978, we feel both failed mostly because it did not address the issues of the minorities. So the key reasons we are bringing this new constitution is to include a power sharing arrangement, which also has to be discussed parallelly along with the constitution, the Constituent Assembly proposed. So hopefully, maybe in about six months' time, once the assembly has started meeting, I may be able to give you a more detailed reply.
Thank you, Minister. Minister, you mentioned that you will be getting your diaspora to a meeting or conference sometime middle of the year. ISAS, we organize South Asian diaspora conferences every 2 years. Our next one is probably sometime in August. And we would very much like, maybe we could invite your Prime Minister to come and talk to the South Asian diaspora, because your diaspora is one of the wealthiest diasporas in the world. In fact, Canadian government is, I'm told, you know, decided by the Sri Lanka National Academy. So they are a very powerful and a very wealthy group of people. So we would very much like them to come and participate in the largest South Asian diaspora, which ISAS organizes every year.
Thank you. I think our Prime Minister would be delighted to participate in the diaspora festival, and perhaps I would like also to invite you to maybe work with us and share the knowledge you have in organizing our diaspora festival in Colombo, because as you rightly said, Sri Lanka has a very vibrant diaspora in many parts of the world. In fact, it was only since we started organizing this diaspora festival that I realized, maybe I'm sure you may have known, that in the United States at NASA, about there are, I was told, nearly 163 Sri Lankan scientists who were working there. So we have Sri Lankans in different fields who have achieved the pinnacle of excellence, from the, some of the best cooks in the world to some very famous rap singers like Missing in Action in the United States. Then we have film directors, many, many authors, and lots of doctors. In fact, many doctors already have indicated that they would like to come to Sri Lanka and do some medical camps for the poor people in the north and the south, in the legal fraternity, in almost in every sphere. So we thought it's high time that Sri Lanka celebrates its own sons and daughters who have done so well in other countries. And they could also be a great inspiration to another generation of young Sri Lankans. Because you see, in Sri Lanka, this word diaspora has been misinterpreted for some time. You know, diaspora in Sri Lanka sometimes is associated with, is unfortunate, but with always they think diaspora means people who support LTT separatists. That's sort of how the average man on the street tend to define. So we want to show them that there is much more, and diaspora means there are Sri Lankans of Sinhalese origin, Muslim origin, Tamil origin, and they will all come to Sri Lanka. They will be invited to Sri Lanka to celebrate the Sri Lankans abroad and talk about their experiences abroad. So maybe I could ask our organizers of this festival also to be in touch with your organization for some advice.
Thank you, Minister. I think we have run out of time. I'll pass the mic back to the MC.
Thank you, Minister and Ambassador. Now, on behalf of ISAS, Ambassador Philip would like